Hi guys, sorry I can't be there today. With the benefits of technology, it's almost like I never left. So the very first question that we're focusing on here is examining the setting, looking at the way that the setting reveals something about the internal state of Aschenbach. And what you'll find in these opening extracts, and there's several of them, is that Venice's attempt to cover up the public health crisis with cholera seems to mesh in some way with Aschenbach's internal secret. You know, the moral degeneration of Aschenbach that's carried out, you know, on the basis of his libido, his sexuality, seems to mirror the exoticism and the foreignness of the cholera epidemic, which is very deliberately exoticized and made Eastern in some way, you know, kind of Asian in origin. It's called Asiatic cholera in the text. And that foreignness seems to be the exact equivalent in some way to the foreignness of Aschenbach's desires and his sexuality. So if you take a look through this opening passage, one of the first things you'll notice is that it describes the way that Aschenbach began to notice certain uncanny developments in the outside world. Now, those uncanny developments seem uncanny because they seem in some way to be connected to him and his own internal state. Remember, the uncanny means something that is both strange and familiar in some way. And so this suggestion of uncanny similarity between himself and the outside world is suggested in that opening line of chapter 5. He notices also that the guests is diminishing in number at his hotel, and particularly the German language seems to be dying away into silence all around him. What this also seems to suggest is his own previous identity and his linguistic power, and something there emphasizing his foreignness and his strangeness in this particular context, that his source of power and his source of previous identity is dying away, and he himself is emerging into this sort of sense of newness. So that in the end, only foreign sounds fell on his ear. And so there we've got that sense of otherness and exoticism that is providing the setting and the context for Aschenbach's final decline, you know, his final almost defeat by these sort of Dionysian impulses in his character. A little further down, it describes the smell. He did not find his idol at St. Mark. He goes wandering looking for Tadzio, but at tea, sitting at his round wrought iron table on the shady side of the piazza, he suddenly scented in the air a peculiar aroma, one which it now seemed to him he'd been noticing for days without really being conscious of it, a sweetish medicinal smell that suggested squalor and wounds and suspect cleanliness. And so this sort of olfactory imagery and sensory description is a window into the corruption of the city, and also the corruption of his own soul, you know, the corruption of his own identity and his previous version of himself as this restrained intellectual. This is something ironic here further down. It says that corners printed notices had been pasted up, which the civic authorities, with fatherly concern, gave warning to the local population that since certain ailments of the gastric system, you know, the kind of bowels and stomach, were normal in this weather, they should refrain from eating oysters and mussels, and indeed from using water from the canals. And the euphemistic character of the announcement was obvious. And so there's something kind of ironic here and revealing again about the narrator and Aschenbach's distance, in that there seems to be some sense that Aschenbach can notice this euphemism in the way that Venice handles its dirty secret. And yet he can't necessarily spot the sort of extended intellectual euphemisms that he has performed out through his thinking about Tadzio as this sort of Apollonian embodiment of divine beauty. And so there's a great kind of irony about that, and there's also a great sense there that it, you know, if it's his narrator noticing this, and the narrator is also then fully aware of all of Aschenbach's kind of euphemisms of thought and extended efforts to justify his own sexual impulses. And so we've got then again the suggestion of distance between the two and the kind of irony about the way that Aschenbach is presented. Further to this, over the page, describes how visitors of other nationalities evidently knew nothing, suspected nothing, still had no apprehensions. They want it kept quiet, thought Aschenbach, in some agitation, throwing the newspapers back to the table. They're hushing it up. But at the same time, his heart filled with emotion at the thought of the adventure in which the outside world was about to be involved. For to passion as to crime, the assured everyday order and stability of things is not opportune in any weakening of the civil structure. Any chaos and disaster afflicting the world must be welcome to it, as offering a vague hope of turning such circumstances to its advantage. This passage here is really interesting at paralleling the external conflict of public display and secrecy with the internal conflict of Aschenbach's own state. We hear for passion as to crime. You know, there's an equivalent between, there's an equivalent comparison set up between Aschenbach's own libidinous desire for Tadzio and the immoral crime that the city of Venice is carrying out in covering up its cholera epidemic, which it seeks to cover up purely for money. And then we've got this idea that the assured everyday order and stability of things is not opportune. Any weakening of the civil structure, any chaos and disaster affecting the world must be welcome to it. And so here, this everyday order of things that we seem to be talking about from the perspective of civic structure in Venice, I think represents Aschenbach's own Apollonian rigidity and the civic structure of his identity that has crumbled and that is dwindling away. And so we've got, again, this suggestion of this external equivalent for Aschenbach's own internal conflict and at this point, degradation. And then it extends this by saying Aschenbach felt an obscure sense of satisfaction at what was going on in the dirty alleyways of Venice, cloaked in official secrecy. This guilty secret of the city, which merged with his innermost secret, which it was also so much in his own interest to protect. And here we've got, you know, a direct articulation of this on the part of the narrator, that he feels this sort of obscure bond with the city of Venice at its keeping a dirty secret, in the same way that Aschenbach appears to be. And so there's this great sense of the place and the protagonist in some way merging in terms of their morality and their state of degradation. Well, finally, a little further down, a passage begins. On Sunday, for example, the Poles never appeared on the beach. He rightly guessed that they were attending Mass in San Marco and hastened to the church himself. There, stepping from the fiery heat of the piazza into the golden twilight of the sanctuary, he would find him whom he had missed, bowed over a prie-dieu and performing his devotions. Then he would stand in the background on the cracked mosaic floor amid a throng of people kneeling, murmuring and crossing themselves, and the massive magnificence of the Oriental temple would weigh sumptuously on his senses. At the front, the ornately vested priest walked to and fro doing his business and chanting. Incense billowed up, clouding the feeble flames of the altar candles, and with its heavy, sweet, sacrificial odor, another seemed to mingle, the smell of the sick city. So again, we've got this kind of indulgent olfactory and sensual imagery that's being used to depict the internal chambers of this, of the church in San Marco. And yet that sort of sumptuous decadence of the place merges with this sense of illness and foreign corruption that the cholera epidemic seems to represent in the text. And so we've got then the suggestion of this exoticism that you see in the style and the aesthetic and the art and the architecture of Venice, in some way being morally reprehensible, you know, being tempting in a way that sort of the rigidity of more kind of European, obviously European architecture like you would find in Munich. You know, there's a suggestion here that that Eastern atmosphere, that some of the Byzantine structures that you see in Venice, that Eastern atmosphere that they contain is in some way tempting to the senses through its indulgence and is seductive and decadent in the same way that Aschenbach's libido is seductive and decadent. So again, we have this complex interaction between the location itself and the internal state of the protagonist. Lastly, concerning the city itself, there's a description of the air and the masonry and the architecture of the place. It says, the air was stagnant and malodorous. The sun burned oppressively through the haze that had turned the sky to the colour of slate. So we've got, again, this suggestion that the sensory conditions of living in Venice, the sensory reality of the place itself, is in some way kind of excessive or indulgent or tainted by a sense of corruption. Water lapped against wood and stone, the gondoliers call half warning and half greeting. You know, if you think of that as a metaphor for the way that Venice seems to almost function itself to Aschenbach, it's kind of half warning him with all these prognostications of doom and these ominous examples of foreshadowing, and yet greeting and seducing him nevertheless. It was answered from a distance out of the silent labyrinth in accordance with some strange convention. Out of little overhead gardens, umbelliferous blossoms spilled over and hung down the crumbling masonry, white and purple and almond scented, with again this suggestion of the merging of this wild sort of sensory imagery that you see through the description of these sort of sprawling, explosive blossoms spilling from the masonry over those buildings in the way that, you know, Aschenbach's passion seemed to be kind of bursting through the rigid confines of his previously rational mind. And then the Moorish windows are mirrored in the murky water, and again you've got that connotation of otherness, of easternness, of exoticism being mirrored in this slightly murky water that in some way I think connotes his subconscious mind. You know, there's an exoticness being suggested about the way that the architecture is mirrored in this murky, unclear water, in the same way that that exotic passion is being expressed in the murkiness of Aschenbach's subconsciousness. The marble steps of the church dipped below the surface, a beggar squatting on them, protesting his misery, holding out his hat and showing the whites of his eyes as if he were blind. An antique dealer beckoned to them with crawling obsequiousness as they passed his den, inviting them to stop and be swindled. This was Venice, the flattering and suspect beauty, this city, half fairy tale and half tourist trap, in whose insalubrious air the arts once rankly and voluptuously blossomed. If you look at this phrase of Venice being this uncertain place of fairy tale and tourist trap, of seductive, idealized, artistic beauty and sinister source of danger, and then its insalubrious air, its unhealthy atmosphere, the arts rankly and voluptuously blossomed. And again, there's that suggestion of his passion that is blossoming voluptuously with this great sense of sensory pleasure. But there's something rank and immoral and degenerating about the passion itself. It says, where composers have been inspired to lulling tones of somniferous eroticism. So where musicians, and again, something Dionysian, have been lulled with something that is both sleep-inducing and yet erotic at the same time, as if the sleep is of reason and of rigidity. Gripped by his adventure, the traveller felt his eyes drinking in this sumptuousness, his ears wooed by these melodies. So there's this huge sense of sensory absorption that Aschenbach is going through here that is not in any way being regulated by his rational mind. He remembered too that the city was stricken with sickness and concealing it for reasons of cupidity, of kind of greed, and he peered around still more wildly in search of the gondola that hovered ahead. And so he finds himself being kind of deeply seduced by this sensory overload that Venice represents in its seductive visual and olfactory, often nature.